Blackstone Audio presents Jordan County, A Landscape in Narrative by Shelby Foote. Rain Down Home. Dawn broke somewhere up the line, pearly under a drizzle of rain, but presently the rain left off and the flat eastern rim of earth was tinted rose. The sun came up fast, dark red while still half hidden, the color of blood, then fiery as it bounced clear of the landline, shining on the picked-over cotton that hung in bluing skeins on dead brown stalks. Ahead, the engine was rounding a curve, and suddenly a plume of steam was balanced on the whistle. It screamed, much as a hound will bay once in full course for no reason at all. Then the plume disappeared, and it hushed. The rain returned, but the sun still shone, pale yellow through the mizzle. "I ought to watch," the young man told himself. He spoke aloud, but that was the last he remembered. He slid back into drowsiness and slumber, taking with him only the present sensations of dusty plush and cinders and vibration. "Don't," he said. The hand nudged at his shoulder again, and the voice came back as if from a long way off. "Bristol," it said, "all out." He saw the hand, the black cuff with its gold thread stars and bars of long-term service toward retirement, and looking up he saw the conductor himself, the face with its halo of white hair, the broken veins of the nose, the jowls and dewlap. "Hey? End of the line, all out for Bristol." Then he woke. It was there, outside the window, in broad open daylight. He had stayed awake all night, riding south out of Memphis through the 100-odd miles of blackness, with only the soft gold gleam of cabin lanterns scattered at random across the fields, and the infrequent sudden garish burst of street lights announcing towns, and then had slept through the arrival. "Thanks," he said. Rising, he was about 25, rumpled and unshaven after the all-night train ride, he took his suitcase from the overhead rack and carried it down the aisle of the empty coach. At the door under the rear platform, he turned suddenly, looking back, and saw what he had known he would see. The conductor stood there, watching him, the ticket punch in his left hand glinting highlight. He narrowed his eyes and pulled his chin down. "What's the matter?" he said. "You think I'm drunk or something?" The conductor shrugged and turned away. He smiled, swung the door ajar, and stepped onto the platform. Brilliant early morning sunlight struck him across the eyes as he came down the iron steps to where the flagman stood on the concrete quay, the brass buttons on his coat as bright as the sun itself. "Mississippi, hey?" the young man cried. He smiled as he spoke. "That's right," the flagman said. "Home again." "Jordan County. You think it'll rain?" "Oh, sure. Cotton's all in. Why not?" "Why not?" he said, waving his hand, and went into the depot. He intended to leave his bag with the ticket agent, but the agent was busy at his window with three Negroes. Gray-faced, they wore funeral clothes, dark suits with heavy watch chains and boiled collars. The agent was scratching his head, grave-faced too. They had accompanied a dead friend to the station. They wanted to ship him to Vicksburg in his coffin. That was easy enough. The problem was they wanted him sent back 2 days later for a second funeral. He had lived both in Vicksburg and in Bristol, with large brothers and relatives in each. And since the widow insisted on burial here, they figured it would be cheaper, more convenient all around, that is, to send him to Vicksburg so his friends could see him there, laid out in style, than it would be for all those people to leave their jobs and buy railroad tickets to come up here and see him. Then they would ship him back to Bristol for the second funeral and the burial. That made sense. The trouble lay in the question of fares. First class was the normal rate, but the agent was not so sure about the propriety of selling a round-trip ticket to a corpse. His friends maintained he was entitled to it, but the agent was doubtful. He was not even sure but what it might be sacrilegious. "I'll call the office and get a ruling," he was saying, still scratching his head as the young man left with the suitcase. Again, in brilliant sunlight, he walked westward down the main street of the town. Cars went past or paused at intersections, obedient to the traffic lights suspended between poles, the lidless glare of red and green, the momentary blink of amber, relaying the orders of some central brain, peremptory, electric, and unthinking. The young man frowned. When he had gone two blocks, he stopped and gazed across the street.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.